Good morning, and welcome to Vestavia Hills Baptist Church. I'm Gary Furr, the pastor, and I want to welcome you from wherever you are worshiping with us today, and thank you for joining in. Every year, our church participates in Children's Sabbath, and we are observing that today in our church as we join faith communities around the world. Children's Sabbath is a day that began as a way to celebrate children as gifts from God, but also a day when we remind ourselves that all the children of the earth need those who act on their behalf and stand up for them, that children need to know that they all matter very much to us. We are also concluding our stewardship emphasis in the church this week. We call our campaign, Count Me In. We've been letting each other know as a church about our pledges to say we're ready to undergird and support the budget for 2021 as we will be in a time of coming back together, hopefully, and strengthening and rebuilding our ministries here on our campus. And as we conclude that special emphasis today, we've been getting lots of wonderful short testimonies about various ministries of the church. And today we conclude that emphasis with these that you will see right now as a part of our welcome.
Count me in.
Count us in.
Count me in.
Count me in.
Count me in.
You can count us in.
Count me in.
I and my family are saying, count us in.
Count me in.
Count us in.
Count us in.
Count us in.
For the glory of the skies, for the love.
The epistle reading is Ephesians 6, 1-4. Children, obey your parents as believers in the Lord. Obey them because it's the right thing to do. Scripture says, honor your father and mother. That is the first commandment that has a promise. Then things will go well with you. You will live a long time on earth. Fathers, don't make your children angry. Instead, instruct them and teach them the ways of the Lord as you raise them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The gospel reading this morning is Luke 2, verses 41 through 52. Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the Passover feast. When Jesus was 12 years old, they went up to the feast as usual. After the feast was over, his parents left to go back home. The boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but they were not aware of it. They thought he was somewhere in their group, so they traveled on for a day. Then they began to look for him among their relatives and friends. They did not find him. So they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courtyard. He was sitting with the teachers. He was listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at how much he understood. They were also amazed at his answers. When his parents saw him, they were amazed. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been worried about you. We have been looking for you everywhere." "Why were you looking for me?" he asked. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he meant by that. Then he went back to Nazareth with them and obeyed him. But his mother kept all these things like a secret treasure in her heart. Jesus became wiser and stronger. He also became more and more pleasing to God and to people. This is the word of Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God.
Please join me in the Litany for Children's Sabbath. People brought children to Jesus that he might pray for them. We too bring children today. We pray for children in our church, in our community, and in our world. May our hands be the hands that hold. We pray that all children will have the health care and educational opportunities they need to grow in wisdom and stature. May our hands be the hands that advocate for children. We pray for children who are vulnerable, those victimized and exploited, those who are poor and hungry and homeless, and for those without family. May our hands be the hands that help. We pray for children who are living within the stress of these current days. May each child be surrounded by the steady guidance of loving adults. May our hands be the hands that offer hope. We pray for the spiritual nurture of all children, that they may know of your constant love and live a life in the fullness of your care. May our hands be the hands that offer guidance. God of every good and perfect gift, we ask that you now bring to mind the children in our own lives. We offer prayers for them by name. May we be moved to open our minds, our eyes, and our hearts so that we too will embrace the children as we follow Christ's example. For children are God's gifts to the world and Christ's call to the church. With the mind of Christ and in the spirit of unity, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
My soul drew back, guilty of dust and sin. But quick-eyed love, observing me grow slack from my first entrance in, drew nearer to me. Questioning if I lack anything. Aghast I answered, worthy to be here. Love said, shall be he. I, the unkind, ungrateful, my dear, I cannot look on thee. Love took my hand and smiling did reply, "Who made the eyes but I? Truth, Lord, but I have marred them. Let my shame go where it doth deserve." And know you not, says love, who bore the blame, my dear, then I will serve. Sit down, says love, and taste my meat. So I did say, and eat.
Please pray with me. Creator of all good things and giver of every gift, Jesus, we thank you for the blessings you give us and ask you to help us be good stewards of those gifts. Allow our blessings to be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's bow together in prayer. Loving God, your passion made the world through your word. On this day, as a church that cares for its children, we come to expand our caring and remember families and children everywhere. The faces of our own children near us are those that we know so well and love. And when we look on them, we understand the sacrifice and love that family requires most deeply. Loving our children is planted in us. It is innate. But on this day, we have come as your church to enlarge our hearts and ask you to expand our love outward. We need your help to do that. For in this time, we are unable to go and do the things we once could do. And so our looking outward and caring beyond our boundaries can only be done with screens and reading and hearts and videos and prayers. But we know that across this planet, children need us. So give us hearts that are open to them and overflowing to care for all the children of this world and not just our own, so we might begin to see them in our hearts as you see them and love them with time and resources and mission vision and devote ourselves as your church to their spiritual well-being. And whether that means teaching them the gospel or how to read or building a school, feeding children who are hungry or giving them the bread of life for their soul, we pray to understand what your will in this troubled world for its children is for us, and that we would have the faith of Jesus Christ to do it, and the love of Jesus to do it gladly, and the courage of Jesus to do it no matter what stands in our way. As your church in this place, would you help us to give our energies and resources more and more to making a difference in our world, to advocate for what is right and best and true and fair for everyone, and care about those who are neglected and forgotten and sometimes in pain? Would you show us the pathways of caring that our calling asked for? Lord, on this day, we pray for health and for peace and prosperity. But even more, we pray for equity and decency and generosity for the children of earth, that ours could become the world you see as real possibility, that suffering be ameliorated and kindness multiplied and families strengthened and upheld by the choices we make. Please minister through us to our own children to teach them the gospel and to model your kingdom and lift up love of neighbor as the way we choose to live. We pray for all in your world who are wounded and battered by troubles today, through wars or pain or pandemic or sorrow. And may there be genuine peace across this earth, and lasting justice. And may each one of us in our praying and our going and our ministry, our voting, our thinking, our advocating, and our caring be the instruments through which it is done. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. In this text in Genesis 43 today, we have the story of Joseph reuniting with his brothers. And I want to focus on the end of that passage when Joseph then tricks his brothers by having things planted in their sacks so that they have to be called back, and they believe themselves to now be under accusation. And they are called in to face him. And now this brother that they had first thrown to die and then gave into slavery and now thought long dead finds himself in the position of power and influence, and the brothers are there with their hats in their hand, fearful of their own lives. And he asks about the father, the old man of whom they spoke, and they say, yes, sir, he is still alive. And then he looked up and saw his brother Benjamin, his mother's son, and said, is this your youngest brother of whom you spoke to me? God be gracious to you, my son. And with that, Joseph hurried out because he was overcome with affection for his brother. And he was about to weep. So he went into a private room and wept there. Because it's not the center of the story, it's a detail that almost goes past us before we see it. But there are so many things in a story to stop and ponder. Now, we're nearing Thanksgiving, a time when traditionally families come together, and we normally begin making jokes about having to go to mom's house or whether the prodigal child and his mean wife are going to be coming this year or how soon we can leave without offending Aunt Susie. But this year's different because now we feel the absence, the ache of separation and loss of family nearness. And the truth is, we are realizing how much we need our families. We were born for this communion, for community, for relationship, and we die if we don't have it. Even our personal identity wouldn't exist without a family, would it? And yet families struggle precisely because of this dependence and closeness that can sometimes suffocate us. No question, family life now is different. You have a list of 15 phone numbers to reach your family of three. You text your son to let him know it's time to come down and eat, and he sends back an emoji to let you know he's on the phone with Charlotte, and you don't know who Charlotte is. Your grandmother clogs up your email inbox, asking you to send her a JPEG file of your newborn so she could create a screensaver. You pull up in your own driveway and use your cell phone to see if anyone is home yet. You clean up the dining room, which means getting the fast food bags out of the back of the van. It's a different kind of time. So any family tree produces fruit, but it also produces lemons and some nuts and a couple of bad apples every now and then. The question is, what am I to do with this reality of family that is both joy and pain? And how crucial it is for children of the earth to have good families. And what will it mean to us to take care of our families? Now, in the broader sense, taking care of families means as a society, we do everything we can to undergird families and be the village that they need to help in rearing children, because truthfully, children do need the whole village. They do need the community. They do need all of us. They need schools, and they need community leaders, and they need organizations and all the things that they do. But what do we do as individual families to be part of that process of caring and making things the best that they can be? Now, fortunately, the Christian church has always been very realistic, or at least most of the time, and accepted that the family is never perfect and its people not always ideal. And this is important today because Christians have had a little bit of a tendency in recent decades to search for simple principles and books and five things that can lead us back to the Christian family, quote unquote, as though those families ever existed without the realities of human nature. Yet we can commit another mistake if we underestimate the importance of family. Family systems therapists often quote this maxim, "By the family you are broken, and by the family you are healed." That is, making peace with where we've come from is part of getting to the best parts of life. Now, at its best, a family adds to affection virtues like supportive caring and tenderness and instruction and forgiveness and helping. At their worst, families can cripple members with destructive anger, an unforgiving spirit, abuse, neglect, selfishness, and disregard for each other. C.S. Lewis once said that love in its most pervasive and simple form in humans is the word affection. That's here in this passage. Affection is that unending biological reality in you and me. That relationship and not contempt is what happens with familiarity. Did you hear what I said? Familiarity doesn't breed contempt, but originally it creates familiarity and affection. Being born to a family and growing up around each other creates a bond, whether we like it or not. Now, there are people who may never become objects of romantic love, he said, but anyone can be an object of affection, even the ugly, the stupid, even the exasperating, Lewis said, can be objects of affection. Because affection is created as simply as the experience of being around somebody long enough that an attachment begins to form. So we have affection, even when the experience with the person is up and down. This explains how children from troubled homes, in all defiance of experience, keep coming back, keep searching for the connection that is not what they want it to be. People who have experienced trauma in families continue to act out in repetitious ways, trying to make sense out of what was damaged in their life. And so we make a fatal mistake if we ever think the answer is just rid ourselves of these relationships once and for all. And there are people who move across the planet trying to do that. And yet they're not done. The bond is too strong, the impressions too permanent. Now here in Joseph's story, we have a great narrative of this complexity. And the story is very simple. It's like this. Joseph was not the one in line to inherit everything according to the laws of that time, but he was daddy's favorite. And because of that, his other 11 brothers resented him. And eventually, when he paraded his favorite status in front of them, tossed him down a well, and they were going to leave him to die out there, but decided the more humane thing to do would be to sell him into slavery in Egypt. So they did, and off he went. And through a series of misfortunes, he becomes eventually an advisor to the king, and his gifts are recognized, and he is the number two guy in all of Egypt. And his brothers come down during a famine, having to ask their brother for help, not knowing that it's him. And there's this long story where Joseph is still hidden from them, and he is playing back and forth and waiting for the right moment to reunite with them. And when he does, in him, it is a very poignant moment of joy. With the brothers, it is terrifying. Nobody knows what's going to happen. Is he going to order them executed? Is he going to get his revenge that he always wanted to do? But he doesn't, because Joseph, in the interim, through all of the difficulties he's gone through, has moved from being a sort of irritating jerk to a wise and deep human being. And when it is finally revealed, and his brother's fear is obvious to him, he says, "Don't worry, I'm not going to hurt you. What you intended for harm, God has used for good." And then the overstory of that is that by this means, Israel is saved and preserved during a time of terrible famine. And it also provides the occasion eventually for the deliverance in the book of Exodus. So there's God's story going on up above this thing all the time, which says, even in our most dysfunctional things, God is mysteriously, creatively at work for good things that are beyond our bad motives. Now, in that story then, when they come, there is this moment where Joseph hurries out because he was overcome with affection for his brother. The old King James said, "And he made haste, for his bowels did yearn for his brother." I'm sort of glad we don't say it that way anymore. The most important work you and I do in most of our life, let's be honest, has to do with the people sitting right next to us. Our children, parents, brothers and sisters, grandchildren, aunts and uncles, cousins. And what we do to mend our fences and encourage one another and work through the things we go through in life is what will deepen our ties or not. Families are not here primarily for us to be happy and successful, although that's sometimes a part of what happens, but rather to give us those underpinnings by which we might persevere with one another and let affection and love and Christian maturity happen in the matrix of that being around each other for a long time. So what can we do in this time, 2020, in the middle of a pandemic, shut up in our houses together, sometimes separated like Joseph and his father by circumstance, where we are not able to see each other until a vaccine comes, or not able to be around each other without quarantining for 2 weeks. It's a complicated time, and yet there are some things that we can do if we realize how important it is to take care of this affection that we have with each other. The first thing is that we can give up some romantic notions of family and work on the hard-headed task of taking care of it. And we do that by realistic acceptance of one another, which is more like grace than anything else. And one of the things we have to learn to do is to de-escalate and get curious and look at reasons we get angry with one another in families. Sometimes it's hard to sort of look at the story underneath your own anger towards somebody else. Where does that come from? What is it that keeps bothering you? And sometimes it's not too pleasant to look at that. But if you keep having the same old argument over and over, maybe it's time to find a new argument. Maybe it's time to try to understand, why do we keep going down this same useless road, and what put us there? But even more than that, I think there is a capacity of flexibility required for family to work, that there are going to be ups and downs, and there are going to be disappointments and hurts, and it is learning to take what life gives us and the opportunities that come back to us. Joseph had a rare moment when he could go back and find reconciliation for a huge breach in his family life experience. This week, my daughter Katie is in New York. We haven't seen each other for almost the best part of a year. And she started off her conversation. I asked how it was going. She started back teaching school again, and I asked her, and she said, I'm so overwhelmed, I'm so tired. And I said after a few minutes, "Now, honey, years ago when I was growing up, the way you're experiencing now, where everything is so complicated and not so simple, that's the way everything was back then." And she said, "And you walked uphill both ways to school, didn't you, Dad?" Okay, she had me. But I do think there is something about this moment that invites us into a kind of creative playfulness to say, listen, we've got to be able to adapt, move, be flexible, try some things differently. And that's hard when you're set in your ways. In July of 2000, just a few years before Fred Rogers died, he was interviewed about his early vision of what he wanted to do on his television show later on that became an American icon. And he said, "I realized that I wanted to have guests, but I also wanted to present a whole smorgasbord of things that children could choose. They might choose painting, or they might choose playing the cello, that there are a lot of ways that we can say who we are and how we feel, ways that don't hurt anybody. And to me, it seems that this is a great gift. I thought that was a brilliant insight. And what if we worked on making our families, rather than confining places where everybody has to fit into one thing, to say, there's a smorgasbord here. And if you don't want to eat broccoli today, here's something else. And I think that's very important for the flexible creativity to let ourselves have more than one way to do things. If you can't do family, if you can't do Thanksgiving, if you can't do Christmas the way you've always done it, many families right now are talking about more creative ways that they can still accomplish the affection and the nearness of family for this year. Take a positive attitude toward that. Secondly, try to project all the hope and faith you can possibly muster to the children around you. If you need to, fake it. I know it's a little bit of a terrifying time, but we need to be protecting our children from as much reality as we possibly can right now and let them be children. Let them grow up at a steady pace. Show them that there are some really good things still now, and maybe some different things that are better that we could do, and keep them away from too much of the current news. In fact, avoid some of it yourself. A pandemic is terrifying enough, but they don't need all that worry on top of it. I look back and I wonder at the job that mothers and fathers in the Great Depression must have done to keep some hope in their children. Son, daughter, it's going to get better eventually, when nobody really knew when and whether it would. Call on that. We need it. Sometimes just to project that, even when you're not so sure of it, is part of what makes it come to be. Then remember that love can never be quarantined. Everything else can. Your body certainly can. I used to have a Spanish teacher who was trying to teach me Spanish to go on a mission trip, and when I would come over to her house to learn, she would force me only to converse with her in Spanish, and it drove me insane because I'm pretty used to a large vocabulary and complicated thoughts, and I couldn't say it, and I would finally stop and say, I can't say what I'm trying to tell you. And she said, well, then say it in the words that you have. And so I would have to use 10 or 12 little tiny sentences with little simple words, and it took me forever just to say one thing. But if love can't be expressed the way you're used to and is naturally and easily, then take the expressions of love you still have. Use those. Find the ways that are still there. And then I would say, this would be a great time for us to laugh together as much as we can. Laughter is a great gift from God. I think it is one of the holiest things on this planet. Because the capacity to laugh means we have the capacity to step above what we are in and even to make a little fun of it and to have perspective and to give a little less seriousness to ourselves. I don't like to be around people who don't have a sense of humor. I think they're scary. A sense of humor is positive. So laugh together. Listen to each other. Weep with each other. Accept each other the way God accepts us. And forgive each other every day because you'll have to. Now notice that acceptance isn't approval. Joseph never said to his brothers, boys, it's okay what you did to me back there. I actually enjoyed being in that well, and later I got thrown in prison because I was falsely accused. And all of that was really, really a wonderful, wonderful experience. It was not. It was miserable. It's never okay to hurt and lie and abuse and cover up and destroy one another. What Joseph did, though, was to forgive them. That's a completely different reality. I did a children's sermon in South Georgia many, many years ago, and I was trying to make a point, and of course it turned out wrong. It's the danger of children. They'll always come up with another angle. And I said, now, how many of you have brothers and sisters? And they, most of them raised their hands. And I said, is there anything in the Bible that you can remember that could help us getting along with each other at home? And one little boy raised his hand and said, yeah, love your enemies. Well, that wasn't exactly what I had in mind. But I think it's important for us to remember that we are on a journey that requires these spiritual tools of forgiveness and love and appreciation and thanks. And above all, that we remember that we're not in it alone. Joseph's story said in many places, and the Lord was with Joseph. And this enabled Joseph to say at the end of Genesis, what you all meant for evil, the Lord has used for good. Now, if your family is gone or scattered out and you're all by yourself, I want to give you one more word of hope. And that is that the scriptures give us, since Jesus, a broader sense of extended family. It's interesting that of the seven things recorded that Jesus said on the cross, the second sentences were this. He looked down at the beloved disciple and gestured to his mother weeping next to him and said, son, behold your mother. And then he looked at Mary and he said, woman, behold your son. And it said after that, and from that day on, he took her into his own home to take care of her. But there's even more here, because I think John wants us to notice something quite disturbing here, that no son would ever call his mother woman. But rather, Jesus maybe is speaking to Mary as a fellow disciple and is calling out the larger family of God's people and saying, you belong to each other now, and there is still family for us all. And one of the things that I think is important to say to those who are solitary in life is this: you're not without family. You are part of God's family. And we are living out this affection for one another everywhere. Now, this is important because too many contemporary writers about Christian family ask us to memorialize some vision of traditional family until it becomes almost a museum piece. And if we don't live up to that perfect arrangement of things, somehow we're a failure. But the truth is, the crucified Christ, from the cross of his sacrifice, can create all that has been damaged and make it new. He can give to all of us the fellowship of church and of family and of affection that God created us for. Caring for family is not something we do in our spare time. It is one of the most important places where you and I act out discipleship every single day. And it is a place where, when we falter, Jesus himself can help us to make it work. On this Children's Sabbath, we pray that all the families of earth might come to know the beauty of God's hope for families. And as we conclude this time together, would you bow with me in prayer? Rekindle affection when it is damaged in us, O God. Help us rediscover it when it has been cold for a long many years. When we are separated, help us to long again for reunion. And when we are broken, may we find healing in our homes, in our marriages, in our sibling relationships, and in our extended families, as we all make the journey to the cross and back to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. We are so grateful that you've chosen to worship with us today. And as we go from this time of worship, hear now these words of benediction. Now let us go, having observed Sabbath. The Sabbath being a time of rest, it is a time for us also to think about all the rest, all the things that God would have us cherish, ponder, and do. Let us go now, having thought about the children of the earth, to give blessing and hope wherever we may go. Amen.